It's an honor to be with you guys, and I hope everybody understands how hugely significant the deactivation of the San Onofre reactors really is. It's a tremendous step forward in the history of the human race. And I don't overstate that when I say that. It's very, very hard to do, to shut down commercial reactors. But we are now at 100 in this country. This is my 41st year working at this. In 1973, a nuclear company came into a town in Massachusetts where I was living. We had an organic farm. And we vowed to stop them from building it. And today you can go where they were going to build it. The bulldozers never came in. And you can lie down on the grass and look up at the sky and think this would have been two reactors. And now you can drive by San Onofre and see three shut power plants. We have a huge waste issue, but it is a huge deal. So, as they say, mazel tov to all of you. Congratulations. It's a tremendous victory, and it means a tremendous amount. Now, today, as mentioned, I do a lot of writing about Fukushima. I work at night, late at night, and one of the reasons I work late at night is because I never get phone calls. And I go till about 3 in the morning usually, and at 2 in the morning on March 11th, 3 years ago, I got a call. And the guy asked me, my friend David asked me to turn on CNN, and there it was. And, you know, our lives have been not the same ever since. And I think most of us understand the gravity of the situation, but I want to say a couple of things. First of all, to all those out there who say that no one will be harmed by Fukushima, it is the biggest lie ever told. I went into central Pennsylvania. It was nice to see Eric up there. In the year after the accident at Three Mile Island, and I interviewed dozens of people. It was the worst time I ever spent in my life. Cancer, leukemia, birth defects, stillbirths, malformations, open sores, loss of hair, metallic taste in the mouth, animals that couldn't breed. It was like being in a science fiction film, a very bad science fiction film. And yet the industry still persists in saying that no one was killed at Three Mile Island. It's a horrible lie. They say not enough radiation escaped from Three Mile Island to harm anybody. They don't know how much radiation escaped. They will never know how much radiation escaped. All the monitors went off scale during Three Mile Island. They had a thermoluminescent dosimeters which measure radiation where it goes, and there was one that went off scale exactly where it was expected in the northwest quadrant where the wind was blowing, and the industry said it was a defective monitor and it didn't mean anything. That's what the industry does. If you push a button and they have a major disaster, the instant response is always the same. Not enough radiation escaped to harm anybody. That's what they said about Chernobyl. That's what they're saying about Fukushima. And that's what they'll say about the next accident and the accident after that. WIP as well, yes. And let me give you a quick history here. Starting with Hiroshima and Nagasaki. When they bombed Hiroshima and Nagasaki, the military said that when people started losing their hair and all the other horrible things that happened, the military said, well, there's no such thing as radiation. What are you talking about? And then they had to fess up that there was radiation in it, which the scientists knew, of course. The scientists who made the atomic bomb circulated a petition. 80% of the scientists in the Manhattan Project asked the military to drop the bombs in uninhabited areas so that they would demonstrate to the Japanese what we have and not kill all these people. But, of course, the military went ahead and did that. They bombed Hiroshima and Nagasaki, by the way, because those were two of the four cities we deliberately did not bomb so they could test the impact of the bombs with aerial photographs. To this day, the tests and the bombings in Hiroshima and Nagasaki are referred to as announced nuclear tests. And they denied that anybody would have any health effects at Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Then they denied that there would be any health effects from the bombings in the South Pacific, the atomic tests that were conducted in the Marshall Islands, especially at Bikini. This is the 60th anniversary, March 1st, 1954, the Castle Bravo test. They blew up Bikini. It went off twice as powerful as they thought. The wind shifted direction, and an unfortunate ship, the Lucky Dragon, was completely contaminated. 6 of the 23 crew members eventually died of liver cancer. And the chief of the Atomic Energy Commission, Louis Strauss, accused them of being communists and trying to make the Americans look bad because they went and died of liver cancer. What a, that's a communist plot. Louis Strauss is the same guy that said nuclear power will be too cheap to meter. Then, and this is the killer, and this is the one thing you need to always remember when you're debating someone from the nuclear industry. In 1956, Dr. Alice Stewart, who was not looking for anything resembling radiation, found in a survey she was doing that a women who are x-rayed during pregnancy, their offspring will have a doubled childhood leukemia rate. Now she was attacked, she was crucified, she was pilloried, she was blacklisted, you name it, for 30 years. Now, I met Dr. Stewart. She was didn't mess with Alice Stewart. She was an amazing woman. She stood her ground, and then after 30 years in the 1980s, the medical profession finally said, well, maybe we shouldn't really x-ray pregnant women anymore. And maybe when you go have a dental x-ray, you might want to put on a bib. And maybe x-ray technicians should leave the room when they do this day after day after day. The bottom line is there is no safe dose of radiation. There is no dose of radiation that can be shown that it will not harm an embryo or a fetus in utero. There's no such thing. There's no number. And this has been proven time and time again. So when you have these people running around saying Fukushima is the equivalent of eating a banana, we've seen that in this ridiculous movie Pandora's Promise. It's the equivalent of eating banana. It's like flying from New York to Los Angeles. It's like living in Denver. It's utter nonsense. Radiation kills people. Many, many, many people will die as a result of Fukushima. There is absolutely no doubt about it. We have a study that indicates these three Russian scientists surveyed 5,000 studies that were done about Chernobyl and came to the conclusion years ago, this is years ago, that 985,000 people would die from the Chernobyl disaster. And so now I'm in this combat every day, all of you are, about the health effects of radiation. The health effects of radiation are unknown. They cannot be known. The science is imprecise. But there is more radiation coming out of Fukushima than we would ever, ever want to contemplate introducing into our natural environment. 300 tons a day of highly radioactive water every day for in perpetuity are coming through the Fukushima site. What do we have at Fukushima? We have three melted cores that they don't know where they are. If I had described, or any of you had described, to an audience of nuclear engineers what happened at Fukushima on March 10th, 2011, they would have thrown you out of the room, they would have laughed at you, they would have said, you're not credible. If we had described what happened at Chernobyl the day before, on April 25th, 1986, they would have laughed you out of the room. And I heard this from 1973 on, the nuclear industry repeatedly saying, like a mantra, a commercial reactor cannot explode. A commercial reactor cannot explode. A commercial reactor cannot explode. And anyone who dared say that in public, that one could explode, they were deemed as not credible, discredited, you name it. Well, now we've had five of them that have exploded. Five commercial reactors have exploded on this planet. The one at Fukushima, I'm sorry, the one at Chernobyl, when Chernobyl exploded, they said, oh, that's not relevant, that's that old Soviet technology, that has nothing to do with the rest of the industry. Come on. And now, of course, now these four reactors that have blown up, three meltdowns, four hydrogen explosions, these are General Electric reactors. These are American commercial atomic power plants. There are 31 Mark I and Mark II General Electric reactors in the United States. The containment domes on these plants are paper mache, basically, and the geniuses that built these plants put the spent fuel pools up in the air outside the containment domes, 100 feet in the air. And let me tell you something else. I was in Japan in the mid-1970s. I marched with the anti-nuclear movement. We showed them movies, a lot of dialogue. I wrote an article for the Progressive magazine that was published in 1977 that talked about Fukushima and said, the people of Japan cannot believe that the nuclear power industry would build commercial reactors in an earthquake tsunami zone, like Diablo Canyon, for example. But we don't talk about the American ones, right? And by the way, I did three lovely nights in the county jail in San Luis Obispo in 1984. I highly recommend it. Food's not very good. The orange polyester, it's just not my color. But very nice people there. It's very comfortable, and you'll have a good time when we go back up there. But nonetheless, they were warned, they were told repeatedly, do not build nuclear power plants in earthquake zones washed by tsunamis. And it's worse than that. There was, if you look at photographs of Fukushima before the site was built, before the reactors were built, it's hard for me to say this, there was an 85-foot high natural seawall at Fukushima. Units 5 and 6 are up in the air. That's why they didn't get, that's why they didn't explode. They weren't operating at the time. But they weren't, as they could have possibly turned them back on. They weren't severely damaged. Had they been operating at the time, there would have been a lot of problems. But the units 1, 2, 3, and 4, they took down the seawall. There was an 85-foot high hill there going down into the sea. Why? Well, they didn't want to have to pump the water all the way up. And they didn't want to have to unload the components of the reactors and move them up the hill, so they removed the hill. And then they say, well, we couldn't have expected what happened there. Come on. Then, to top that off, they put the backup generators, the backup power generators, in the basement, below sea level, for God's sakes. Who is surprised? Not only did the tsunami wipe out the backup steam generators, but it made it, backup power generators, it made it impossible to ruin the connections. So when they came in with backup, you know, brought them in by trucks, or my favorite, they went out in the parking lot and ransacked automobiles and trucks to take car batteries out to bring into the nuclear power plant. That's how desperate they were. But they ruined the connections. So that when the tsunami came in this below sea level basement, they couldn't plug anything in because it was all destroyed by the tsunami. And they say they couldn't predict this. Totally predictable. Now there's a core problem here, and I won't go on much longer. The core problem is that these are private corporations. TEPCO, which the perpetrators of this global post-apocalyptic disaster, is a private corporation. There is one goal and one goal only in the corporate charter of TEPCO, and that is to make money. Now, we circulated a petition asking that the global community take over at Fukushima so that all the world's scientific and financial resources would be available to deal with the Fukushima crisis. We got 150,000 signatures. We delivered them to the United Nations on November 7th. You know what we heard? Nothing. We've heard nothing, not from the Secretary General, not from TEPCO, not from the Japanese government. But the fact of the matter is that TEPCO, like every utility company in the United States, has no financial liability for any of the damage that they do. It is not in the interest of PG&E or any other corporation that owns a nuclear power plant to protect the public safety because there's no money in it. God forbid Diablo Canyon, and by the way, Fukushima is not a worst case scenario. It is way, way far, way short of a worst case scenario. A worst case scenario is that 9.0 Richter scale earthquake that was 100 miles offshore was 1 mile offshore, or right under Fukushima, or right under Diablo Canyon, or right under Indian Point, for God's sakes, 35 miles north of New York City. Then what you get is rubble. A pile of radioactive rubble with multiple meltdowns, hydrogen explosions, possibly fission explosions. And by the way, we're not 100% sure that there wasn't a fission explosion in Unit 3 at Fukushima. It's quite possible. If you look at the cloud, it may have happened at Chernobyl too. So not only can reactors explode, but they may actually fission and have that problem as well. But nonetheless, TEPCO is not in any way, shape, or form incentivized to protect the public safety. No one from TEPCO has been prosecuted for this, as no one was at Three Mile Island. Chernobyl may be a little different. But and in every case, by the way, not only was the public misinformed at Three Mile Island, at Chernobyl, and at TEPCO, at Fukushima, the governments were misinformed. The President of the United States was lied to by the operators of Three Mile Island. Gorbachev was lied to by the operators of Chernobyl, and certainly not Okan, was lied to by TEPCO repeatedly throughout this disaster. So the bottom line for these guys is this at TEPCO. The cleanup of Fukushima, such as it is a profit center. They are making money playing at cleaning up the site there. Some of the most powerful footage in this film was dealing with the workers there. They didn't really talk about organized crime, but Reuters ran two very powerful articles documenting that the workforce at Fukushima, as was at many of the commercial reactor sites in the United States when these plants were being built, is dominated by organized crime. When you get that many people working on a tight site with tons of money around, you're going to have the mafia in there. There's absolutely no doubt about it. It's a totally corrupt situation. There is no incentive to clean up Fukushima, just like there was none. You know, they're not even done. I'm almost done. They're not even finished at Chernobyl. You know, we just had this, whatever it was, in Ukraine. They're not done putting the sarcophagus over Chernobyl. Who's going to finish that job? So the bottom line is this. TEPCO had an extremely profitable year last year. After all they did to the planet, TEPCO made over $8 billion last year in profits. So what we have to do is do what was done here at San Onofre and do it damn quick. We shut four reactors last year, four commercial reactors. We went down from 104 to 100. Exelon says they may shut five more this year, but we're all living in absolute terror from any one of these commercial reactors. And the good news is, and I'll finish with this, we are in the midst of a technological revolution, unprecedented in human history. Photovoltaic cells will be the biggest industry in the history of the world. Every building, every home, every office, every vehicle, every machine, every handheld device will have photovoltaic cells to convert sunlight to electricity, every one of them. Windmills, biofuels, ocean thermal, geothermal, all these technologies have exploded. Just watch any documentary film with Amory Lovins in it, and you'll understand what's happening here. What's standing in the way of our survival on this planet and of our prosperity as a species is nuclear power. You guys have shown that, you men and women have shown that nuclear power plants, however big and however well funded, with however big a utility behind them, can be shut down. And now we have to duplicate that all over the world. So thank you very much for having me here tonight. And if you have questions.